when we use things like antidepressants and the biomedical model, we say to people, there's something wrong with you and there's something wrong with your brain chemistry, and we're going to fix it with a pill and that's it. And that's not it. You know, that's really just trying to sort of mask it, really. Yeah. And if you think of a seed, it's not going to grow unless it has nutrient-rich soil, the right amount of water, the right amount of sunshine, some nurture, you know, sunshine, rain, nurture, good soil. All of that stuff helps the seed to grow into a powerful tree. You don't blame the seed if it's not been planted or it doesn't have the right nutrients. And I think it's the same with mental health. We need a sense of community. We need to be eating really well. We need to have a sense of purpose, sense of positive emotions, sense of gratitude, sense of love, sense of self-love, so many things like that that will help to ease these feelings of dis-ease, mentally and physically.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Alter Your Health podcast. This podcast is your source of information and inspiration to promote the holistic transformation of your health and the health of our planet. And I'm Dr. Benjamin Alter, your host. I'm a licensed naturopathic doctor and holistic lifestyle medicine practitioner, much like our guest on the podcast today. And my passion, much like the guest on our podcast today, is promoting health globally, connecting people with their own innate ability to heal. And I do this through one-on-one consultations that I offer at Alter Health, www.alter.health, as well as our online education, experiential and transformational educational programs, the Medicinal Living online course and mastermind. We just launched our very first mastermind, and if you would like to join the wait list for our second mastermind, it'll be happening in January. So head on over to www.alter.health/mastermind. Learn about how we weave together the essential medicines to support you in transforming your health, reversing disease, reclaiming your vitality. Now, let's get into this episode, you guys. This episode is with Dr. Gemma Newman. She is the plant power doctor on Instagram. And like I said, Dr. Newman has a special interest in holistic health and plant-based nutrition and lifestyle medicine. Much like myself, we get along just great. And in her practice, she has come to understand that body, mind, and soul are not separate, and that it is only in addressing the root causes of stress and disconnection that we truly heal from the inside out. See, I told you that her and I share common ground here. So in addition to her practice as a holistic lifestyle and medicine practitioner focusing on plant-based nutrition, she is also passionate about the study of psychology and meditation and uses techniques she has learned to help her patients change their mindset to facilitate healing. She is also interested in the field of energetic healing and is a qualified Jikiden Reiki practitioner, having studied this as well as Western style Reiki for the purpose of pain relief. Super cool stuff. We didn't get into the energetic healing approaches that Dr. Gemma Newman offers, but really a fascinating asset of her clinical practice. In this conversation, we did focus on mental health. We focused on the wide spectrum of what we classify as quote unquote mental health conditions. We talk about how some of these quote unquote mental health diagnoses might in fact just be part of the normal human experience, feeling lonely, feeling disconnection, feeling sadness, feeling anxious, and how our emotions can be signs to reconnect with ourselves. So Dr. Gemma and I, like I said, we share a lot of common philosophy here. Dr. Gemma also shares some powerful science and understanding how nutrition, specifically focusing on nutrient-dense, fiber-rich plant foods, can be a powerful medicine to support the balance of our minds. And we talk about all of the nuances, scientifically speaking, of how this mechanistically happens. So Gemma is a wealth of knowledge, a wealth of information, a wealth of experience, and I'm so grateful for her time. She, like I started this conversation off with her, was on the Ritual podcast recently. And in that episode on the Ritual podcast, she dives into her story and how she came into this field of plant-based nutrition. So if you'd like to get a little bit deeper into Dr. Gemma's history, I would love to point you to that episode on the Ritual podcast from a few months back. But enjoy this one as well as we dive into some really great stuff. And just a reminder before we do embark on the journey, if you haven't done so already, I would so appreciate it if you would hit the like button, subscribe and share, leave a comment or rating or review wherever you're tuning in from. I really do appreciate that feedback and support. And also, I would so appreciate it if you would take a moment to express your love and your kindness by sharing this episode with someone in your life who would benefit from connecting and hearing this inspirational and informational stuff. You can find more information about our guest Gemma at gemmanewman.com. That's gemmanewman.com. And for more information on this episode, the show notes, etc., visit www.alter.health/episode144. So let's do it, you guys. Let's take a breath. Let's let it go. And let's dive into this great conversation with my lovely guest, Dr. Gemma Newman, the plant power doctor. All right. Welcome, Dr. Gemma Newman, to the Alter Your Health podcast. I'm so glad we finally made the time to connect here.
I'm very happy to be here with you. I really am. I know it's been a while coming, but I'm excited.
Yeah, it's funny. You know, I stumbled across your Instagram. It's got to be at least a year or so ago and have always really resonated with all of your material. And then, you know, fast forward several months and I was like, oh, it'd be great to connect and dive into some of this stuff in a conversation. And then before I knew it, you were on the Rich Roll podcast. And I was like, oh no, she ditched poor old Dr. Benjamin for Rich Roll.
But, never.
But anyways, I really appreciated that conversation. Felt like I got to know you a little bit in that context, listening to Rich's podcast. And
He's a great guy.
Yeah, I haven't met him in person yet, but look forward to whenever our paths cross. But excited to kind of dive in into something that I've heard you talk about and speak about in a few different contexts, and that's kind of the whole world of mental health and nutrition. But before we do, you know, just for for the listeners that haven't listened to Rich's podcast, that dives a little bit into your story, do you want to just kind of share a little bit of, in terms of like how you got into the realm of plant-based nutrition with your clinical practice?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I've been a doctor for quite some time now, and the interest was always there in making sure that people could make holistic changes to their lives that would improve their health. But I did feel like my toolbox was really half empty when I left medical school, and a lot of the things that you need as a clinician, you learn on the job. But still, I think that the medical model is really set up to help people with acute illness, you know, emergency surgery and life or death situations. That's where it's amazing. But when I went into community medicine, I began to very quickly realize that it just wasn't working. I was helping patients to manage their chronic diseases without really making an impact on healing. And so, you know, my journey has been a big one personally and professionally. But I've always been looking for things to help people. So I learned about solution-focused brief therapeutic approaches. I did some reading around psychology, motivational interviewing. Nutrition, yes, obviously plays a huge role in my practice. Plant-based nutrition was almost, I almost stumbled upon it really, because I had my own journey into health, and I didn't look after myself when I was a young doctor, and I was doing all the night shifts and eating junk food and thinking I was going to live forever. And I just got a bit fed up with feeling a bit in a rut, and I thought, oh, I'll just lose some weight and it can't be that hard, and I'll just do a bit of calorie counting and cut the carbs. And yes, I did. I did lose weight that way, and I did a lot of exercise as well, but you know, my lipid profiles were still raised. I got a lot of knee pain when I was running. And it was actually only when my husband ran the London Marathon and wanted to improve his running time that I stumbled upon plant-based nutrition. I'd never even heard of it before that. And he was not, he's non-medical, by the way. So it's kind of a bit of a bash to the ego to think, oh, could my husband have stumbled upon something that I should have known? But yeah, he was doing his own research, and he managed to improve his running time really significantly by about an hour and 10 minutes after he went plant-based. And I thought, okay, I need to really look into this. And so I did. And obviously then it becomes a bit of a rabbit hole, doesn't it? You start to go in and you realize how much you don't know. And then you realize even more how much you don't know. And you just keep reading, reading, reading until such time that you do feel a little bit more confident. And so, you know, the magic began to happen in my clinical practice when I felt much more confident to share this information with my patients, and obviously sharing it with my family as well. So it's been a real exciting journey for me. And I can sort of say happily that I am completely plant-based, and my lipid profiles are normal, and I don't get knee pains anymore when I run, and I'm significantly older than I was then, and having had two kids in the interim. So I think it's doing something good for me.
Yeah, amazing. I can affirm that it looks like it is doing something good for you in terms of, you know, just I've seen a couple of kind of side by side before and after, and you really do look like a completely different person. You don't necessarily just look healthier, but you just look completely different. And I'm sure you feel completely different as well.
I do. And, you know, in terms of things like mental health, that obviously we're going to talk about that as well. But I tend to be a generally happy person, and I tend to look on the bright side, but I do think that my mental health did improve after I had more natural foods, plant foods. And I've seen that very much as well amongst other people. My patients have told me that significantly so. So yeah, it's about feeling good inside and out, and, you know, sort of dialing up your nutrition is a major part of that. But I'm also looking at holistic things as well. Body and mind are so intimately connected, as we're going to discuss. And food is a major part, but it's also about loving yourself, feeling a sense of gratitude for where you are, really paying attention to who you are, what you want, and who you surround yourself with. So this is it's so many different things, but yeah, obviously nutrition plays a big part too.
Yeah, you know, and you know, something that you touched upon in terms of like the motivating factor for you that kind of got you looking in a different direction in terms of your health and your relationship with your lifestyle. Sounds like it was kind of your weight. And I think that is kind of a starting place for so many. But you also kind of alluded to the fact that weight and your weight is not necessarily the best indicator of your overall health. You know, I remember being at the grocery store and I had like a load of fruits and vegetables on the conveyor belt to check out. And there was a young man who was the cashier. And we were actually in the midst of kind of this fruit and vegetable cleanse over the summer. And he's like, oh, wow, you know, you guys are eating really healthfully. And I was like, yeah, you know, just fruits and vegetables, da da da. And he's like, oh, well, you know, I'm really lucky. You know, I eat kind of junk food, but look at me, I'm super thin. And he was, you know, maybe in his early 20s, but I just kind of pointed out to him, I was like, yeah, that's great. And there's more to health than weight and the size and physique. So thanks for just kind of pointing out that obvious fact that, you know, health on the inside and the out and kind of in each and every cell, not just your overall structure.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And many people can stay slim for their whole lives, but they still die of heart disease and cancer. So these are lifestyle, predominantly lifestyle diseases. And how we look on the outside doesn't always convey the inside. And that's why I feel quite sorry as well when I see people who are that bodybuilding and they have a very high consumption of saturated fat, animal products. And I think these are the guys that end up having a heart attack whilst they're on the treadmill or lifting weights. And, you know, that's not a true reflection of internal health. So you're right, there's more to it. And Definitely.
And then, you know, yeah, you're also talking to the fact that a lot of people just think that they can out-exercise a crummy rest of their lifestyle in terms of stress or alcohol or drugs or food. And people think they can just hit the gym and work it off, but it doesn't really work that way, right?
No, it doesn't. And it feels like it does. That's the sort of seduction of it all. It feels like it can. And maybe for a while it looks like it can, but it doesn't. It doesn't in the long term. And that's what I see as well at work. That's an important message to convey.
Yeah. So kind of opening up the conversation in the world of mental health, what's your personal connection or relationship with mental health? Is it something that you've experienced personally, like some mental health conditions or disturbances, or in your family? Like, yes. How have you become interested in this topic?
Well, my father suffered terribly with mental health issues while he was alive, and he had severe depression. He had to undergo electroconvulsive therapies. He was on heavy medications. He had attempted suicide, and ultimately he died as a result of the heart disease that he was at increased risk of because of his mental health conditions. And so that's probably the biggest link, I think, that I could let you know about. And, you know, for me, actually, it was so tremendously sad to see him suffer, and as a family member to see that deterioration and feel quite hopeless around an inability to help him. And, you know, in part, I think that did sort of prompt my journey into the medical field, because I would like to be the fixer, the helper, the person that can, you know, get people feeling more empowered towards good health. And, you know, it does bring sadness to know that that's something I could never have given him. But I know that I'm not alone in that tragedy, because, you know, many people suffer from mental health conditions, and many people's families, you know, in fact, I'd say almost everybody. Mental health charity Mind says 1 in 4 of us will suffer a mental health problem every single year. And even in young kids now, people are getting more depressed. About 1 in 10 children suffer from depression or anxiety, conduct disorders, self-harm. 1 in 6 adults have a common mental disorder, which would include things like depression, anxiety, post-traumatic stress, OCD. So these things are definitely a huge impact, not just on the people that suffer, but like myself, family members, and of course, wider society. So, you know, that's why I'm so passionate about it, because I've seen it on a very personal level. And, you know, it could be that nutrition played a part for my dad, but I can't pretend that eating more steamed broccoli would have actually made a huge difference to him particularly. But I do see the impact that little changes in all sorts of ways can make. And I think people just don't realize the benefits of things like nutrition for health. So, you know, mental health specifically. So that's why I'm so passionate to share that message.
Yeah, when I, you know, look out into the world of epidemiology and all these kind of trends that are present in our world, you know, we see increasing risk of heart disease and diabetes and cancer and all these lifestyle diseases. And we also see an increased prevalence of all the mental health diseases. And I think that we have a tendency to separate things and to compartmentalize conditions and diagnoses to better understand them as individual phenomenon. But I think that there is kind of an underlying something or other that maybe brings it all together.
Exactly.
So what might that underlying thing be, or what might those things be? There's probably many things that lie at the root of all this.
There are many things. I mean, you're absolutely right. No organism exists without the environment that it grows in. And so it is with depression. You know, what we do, what we eat, who we surround ourselves with, how much we move, our autonomy, our social networks, our passions, our sense of purpose, our toxin exposures. You know, there's so many different things, and they can all play a part in this sort of complex fabric of well-being. I guess, you know, you could look at it a bit like a soil, you know, soil and a seed, for example. Like you could say, you know, I think when we use things like antidepressants and the biomedical model, we say to people, there's something wrong with you and there's something wrong with your brain chemistry and we're going to fix it with a pill and that's it. And that's not it. You know, that's really just trying to sort of mask it, really. Yeah. And if you think of a seed, it's not going to grow unless it has nutrient-rich soil, the right amount of water, the right amount of sunshine, some nurture, you know, sunshine, rain, nurture, good soil, all of that stuff helps the seed to grow into a powerful tree. You don't blame the seed if it's not been planted or it doesn't have the right nutrients. And I think it's the same with mental health. You know, we need a sense of community. We need to be eating really well. We need to have a sense of purpose, sense of positive emotions, sense of gratitude, sense of love, sense of self-love. So many things like that that will help to ease these feelings of dis-ease mentally and physically. So we just need to connect more as well, I think, ultimately. Although we're connected in lots of ways digitally, we're also very disconnected in a lot of ways, especially city living, modern living, when communities are not sort of accountable to people, are not accountable to each other in their communities. They don't have someone looking out for them. Loneliness is one of the key things for sort of depression, especially amongst the elderly, and now amongst teenagers who live their lives on social media. They can feel tremendously lonely because they compare themselves to others. So it's a complex thing, but I think if I bring it back to the seed and the soil analogy, we just got to think, okay, what do I do to love myself? If I was a seed growing, I would need nutrient-rich soil. I would need some sunshine. I would need a little bit of rain. I would need fungal networks beneath the soil, my friends and family, to help me to
grow. Friends, the fungi friends.
Yes, we need fungi friends.
The mycelium fungi, yes, network.
The mycelial, yeah, networks we need to help us to thrive. And it's the same. It's the same for humans. We're not disconnected from our environments. And I think often mood is tremendously linked to that. And I see it in my practice. I honestly do think that in around 80% or more of the people I see, stress, disconnection, anxiety or depression or adverse life experiences play huge roles in their illnesses, even when they're not obviously linked to mental health.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I observed that as well. Can we talk a little bit more about the biochemistry theory behind depression? You know, because it is a theory, right? You know, there's this kind of idea that people who are depressed lack sufficient amounts of serotonin, and you can take this SSRI, the serotonin, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, that keeps more serotonin available. But my understanding is those SSRIs are maybe like a teeny bit better than placebo at controlling or reversing depression, if that. And I know I've seen some studies that suggest that, you know, even going for a walk outside is more effective than an SSRI. So, talk to us about this theory of biochemistry in the brain.
Yeah, I think probably the clearest evidence that I've read was from Professor Irving Kirch, based at Harvard. And he analyzed all the raw data from drug trials from pharmaceutical companies. And he found that the real positive effects from antidepressants was vanishingly small compared to placebo. Natural recovery, even about a third as effective as getting a decent few nights sleep, unfortunately. But the side effects are very real, as are the withdrawal effects, you know, things like weight gain, sexual dysfunction, suicide risk, excess mortality risk in the elderly, type 2 diabetes, risk of miscarriage. And I don't want to scare anybody, because, you know, many people take antidepressants these days. It's very prevalent. But, you know, I do also point out that many people are not suddenly feeling happy. So I don't think that they are the answer to it. And I would say that if you are on an antidepressant medication, don't just stop it thinking, oh, listening to me saying this, oh gosh, I can't continue, I'm going to stop it, it's not working for me, when they feel that it is working. So I'd say, look, if you're on an antidepressant and you feel it's helping you, please do carry on with it and go and see your doctor to talk about withdrawing gradually if and when you are ready to do so. But otherwise, it's worth looking at all the other things in your life that you think you could improve first. And as I say, you know, if antidepressants have worked for someone personally, that's good. I'm not going to want someone's personal experience, but I do want people to be aware that these are not harmless interventions. And for some people, they don't seem to make very, very much difference at all, unfortunately.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I think in general, like people go to the doctor and they assume that the doctor is going to give them a medication that is just safe and effective, wildly so. But any substance carries potential risks, and we call those kind of side effects. But, you know, it was taught to me in my pharmacology class that they're not really side effects. They're just other effects that are not desired, you know?
They're powerful. They're powerful chemicals. And in some ways, the good thing about pharmaceutical drugs is that you know exactly what's in them, and there's a box with the list of all the side effects or effects, as you've rightly pointed out. And sometimes when you're buying something herbal over the counter, it may not be so well regulated. You may have potential contaminants, or you may have varying concentrations of active substances and compounds. So that's another point to make. Sometimes natural remedies have their own potential downsides. But really, as I say, now that we understand a bit more about the potential risks and about the lack of potential benefits in a lot of people, it can help us to think, okay, what do we really need? What does society really need? Let's take a step back and think a lot more holistically about how to help people, support people in society who are feeling down, and change. I mean, it's a big ask, isn't it? Changing society, ultimately, that's what we're talking about. But if somebody can hear this and feel empowered, they can feel like, okay, I have some control over this, and I'm going to make some changes, and I'm going to ask for support and see how this goes. And I'm not strange, and it's not my body being different or weird. It's actually completely understandable, and take some active steps to improve their lives and feel empowered to do so. That's my hope. Mm-hmm.
What do you think about overly pathologizing mental health conditions that are normal human emotional phenomena? Like, you know, when someone has a breakup or loses a pet or a loved one, even, you know, grief is just a natural human emotion. And obviously, grief for months and years and you know, kind of spiraling downward is not maybe optimal, but what do you think about, like, this, our world? Do you think that maybe we're overly pathologizing?
You've made a really good point there. George Brown. Have you heard of George Brown?
I haven't, but maybe I should. Okay. Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you about George Brown. So he's an anthropologist, and he performed years of interviews and prospective research on people for their mental health. And he discovered there was about a 75% chance of depression when something bad had happened to you within the last year. And you had at least one chronic stressor in your life as well. And if you have no good friends or an unsupportive partner, then this dramatically increases the risk. And so in that kind of framework, clinical depression would be an understandable response to adversity. And essentially feeling of hopelessness with your life circumstances at that time. And it brings it back to the environment. We're not separate from our environment, and it's completely normal. Like, of course, say, you know, you go through a devastating loss, your whole life changes. You lose a child, or you go through an assault, or something that would dramatically change your entire paradigm. Of course, you're going to feel low. It's natural. It's part of the grief. It's part of the love that you felt. And the loss feels real because you loved. And that's important. That's something we need to recognize. So again, it's not about forcing yourself to feel happiness, because really what we should aim to do is to accept every emotion as it comes and love that emotion and aim to understand that emotion and just give it love. do not push it away, because if you're pushing it away, it stays, it lingers, and it won't ever leave.
What you resist persists. And I've always understood, and I think it's been taught to me in some context, that mental health is not happiness. Mental health, like you kind of pointed out, mental health is the freedom to experience the whole wide rainbow of emotions without getting too entangled and or stuck in any one of them. I think that given our world today, given social media, given our environment, we've got this false sense of what life should be like, and anything that's not that ideal is somehow wrong or needs to be fixed or corrected.
Oh God, totally. And I think comparison is the enemy of happiness. It really is, like deep soul happiness I'm talking about. Actually feeling deep soul happiness. You cannot compare yourself to other people, because that just never works. And social media is that.
And you can tell me that all day long, and I can know that conceptually all day long. I sit here all day just looking, oh, look at that guy. He's better than me. Look at her. She's better than me. What am I doing? You know, it's like, so back to
don't do it. Don't do it to yourself then. Just don't do it.
Well, thank you for that cheerleading encouragement. But like, it's just back to that point that, you know, I think there's, on some hand, there's nothing wrong with it. It's just a normal human tendency. And for me to beat myself up and think that it's wrong and think that I need to fix it, just kind of adds more weight and pressure and discomfort. So,
do you find that you compare yourself to others online most days?
Most day, yeah, I would say at least one time a day. There's kind of a thought. Maybe it's a fleeting thought. Maybe it's 12 thoughts that pile up on top of each other. But
yeah,
I would say most days there's at least a thought of that.
Yeah, it's tough. It's tough because that tends to come hand in hand with a feeling of wanting to make a difference. I think, especially for someone like yourself.
Yeah, I'm in that camp as well.
Yeah, yeah. So you want to make a difference, and so it's like, come on, I want to make more of a difference. But I mean, my only advice from that point of view would just be really to feel the positive emotions of what you're doing more than anything else, because then things just sort of can come more easily. It's less of a struggle. It's kind of, it's just more, you know, it's just going to happen.
What I hear you saying is like allowing the positive emotions of what I'm doing to kind of overwhelm or outweigh the negative, quote unquote, like the thoughts.
Because love is the overriding emotion that is the most powerful thing. And that's the emotion that you use in order to help the world and help the people in it. And that is more powerful than anything else, more powerful than feeling of sort of dissatisfaction or potential mild envy. And when you're living in that, other people's stuff doesn't matter. And then you find that, you know, the phone will start to ring and things start to happen and you start to make more of a difference and you notice it more.
Yeah, you know, it's that universal phenomenon that you kind of pointed out, that what you resist persists and what you kind of want and what you crave stays away.
And it's that emotion of wanting and craving, and that's what you stay in then. If you stay in the wanting and craving, that's what keeps coming back to you, and it just keeps it keeps coming back. Whereas if you just, it's easier said than done, but if you can if you can feel the love and the gratitude, then the love and the gratitude just keeps coming back to you.
100%. Get in that gratitude wave.
It's tough though, isn't it? I know it's very tough, especially we can't help it. It's human nature, isn't it, sometimes to feel these things. It makes sense.
It does. And, you know, once again, my kind of newish approach is to make it normal and make it okay rather than make it something to fix.
Yeah, exactly. It's just another part of being human.
Yeah. Well, shifting kind of towards kind of treatment or therapeutic interventions to what may be normal human emotions of like sadness or anxiety, or, you know, on that note, like anxiety was once told to me, I was told that anxiety is really just excitement that is suppressed or constrictive, because anxiety to some extent is once again also some flavor of a human, natural human emotion.
I mean, I would say that anxiety is, from my perspective, it's more your body telling you that your brain isn't listening. That your body knows something, that your brain is kind of trying to push away from. I mean, don't get me wrong, there are many other facets to it. It's not that straightforward. Certain things like even like caffeine and other environmental factors can play a part. But I think that when your parasympathetic nervous system is truly engaged, then anxiety just tends to melt away. And when you're feeling in a more sympathetic nervous system overdrive, then anxiety stays with you quite significantly, whatever you're up to. And that's tough. And sometimes it's because your body is trying to tell you something. You know, you're not necessarily listening to that sort of gut instinct of whatever it is, the situation in which you find yourself in life, or you're feeling powerless to change. And I think that that can be one of the keys to chronic anxiety. It's just this sense of physical unease because your brain hasn't listened to what your soul really needs sometimes. But it's never that simple.
Thank you. Thank you so much for articulating that, because that's something that I convey as well. And that like all human emotions that aren't pleasant, like anything except for our peaceful, loving essence, is kind of feedback, is kind of pointing us back to who we truly are. And what was the phrase that you led that off with, like our anxiety is when the body isn't listening to the brain? Or
what did I say? I think I said that anxiety is when the brain's not listening to the body.
Yeah,
your brain is trying to do something that your body and soul is kind of not quite sure about.
Yeah, it's kind of like some biofeedback, like there's kind of this disharmony, out of alignment feeling, and the more it intense the feeling gets, like the more it's trying to wake us up to what is in our highest good.
That's one of the things that I see in people in their lives, and again I really try not to oversimplify, but I think that's really the essence of it, is to say to somebody, you know, what's in your soul and what's your soul trying to tell you? And your body knows, because your body's reacting, but your brain's trying to convince you that something else is really true. And I think that can be a key to it.
Totally. I think that's a really important place to look at, you know, what the soul is yearning or asking for. What does this mean? What does this mean? So like, it sounds like you do a lot of kind of counseling and talking and working through stuff with probably your clients, and also probably your family members and friends, and just being a kind human that you are. But like beyond the kind of talking, counseling, understanding, I'd like to shift maybe towards like therapeutic applications of food as medicine. And in your experience, I trust that you've witnessed the power of food to support people in healing and letting go of these mental health conditions. But I'd like to talk about maybe any science around this that you are connected with.
Absolutely. There was a meta-analysis published, I think, in the Journal of Psychosomatic Medicine earlier this year that showed that anxiety was connected with diet. And when people had improvements in their diet, then there was a correlation with that and massively reduced anxiety. And
were there any specifics around, was it just like good diet, No anxiety, bad diet, anxiety?
The trend was that when you had more fiber, fruits, vegetables, and polyphenols, you had less anxiety. And when you had more processed foods and fatty foods, you tended to have more anxiety in that study. There was a study on Taiwanese elderly populations that was about 1600 elderly Taiwanese, and there was a relative risk reduction of about 62% in terms of depression the more vegetables they ate. Then goodness me, there's so many. There's a lot of studies around weight loss and then having mood as kind of like almost a side effect. So there was one study of about 106 obese and overweight people. They gave them a high carb healthy diet, half of them, and the other half they gave a low carb healthy diet, and predictably both cohorts lost weight and felt better after about a year. But interestingly, it was the high healthy carbohydrate diet that had a statistically significant boost in mood scores and productivity compared to the low carbers. There's a couple of randomized controlled trials I can tell you about that are using food as a specific intervention. So I think the most well-known one is probably the SMILES trial that was published back in 2017. And they used a group of people, I think there's 67 participants, and half of them they gave food, a modified Mediterranean diet, as a therapeutic tool for improving mood. And the other half they gave social support to, so it was more of a sort of psychological intervention. And then over the course of 3 months, they found that those who had the social support intervention had about an 8% remission rate, whereas those who were on the modified Mediterranean diet, about a third of them went into remission for their depression, which you can see there's a big difference, like four times difference in the amount of people that had a benefit.
I mean, I would think that the social support would maybe outweigh nutritional support, but food is more powerful.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And then they've got the Geico study, which was done. I hadn't heard of Geico before I read the study, but you probably know it's a big insurance company, car insurance company. And they got about 300 participants in about 10 cities across the US. And they gave them a once a week kind of education session about plant-based nutrition and the benefits, and they offered them a plant-based meal at the cafeteria. They didn't have to eat it, by the way. There was no compulsion for them to pick it, and there was no kind of control over what they ate the rest of the time at home. And what I found fascinating is that in that study, those that had the education session, yes, they lost weight, yes, they improved their markers for disease, diabetes, heart disease and such like, but the mood effects, they had dramatically boosted mood, reduced depression, anxiety, and increased productivity. So it's really interesting how a lot of the time you can see a nutritional intervention has the side effect of boosting mood. And I've seen that time and again with my patients as well. Like they come off antidepressants because they feel so good.
I think we can all kind of wrap our minds around the common sense of, all right, you're eating good, you're feeling good, you're got less pain, there's less inflammation, you know, you're maybe more able to get outside and move your body and have good quality time with loved ones. But what are some known or proposed mechanisms? Like people talk about the gut brain connection and like increased fiber is all obviously going to diversify the microbiome and kind of enhance that gut brain connection relationship. But what are some other kind of mechanisms of how food is so powerful of a drug for mental health? It's not obviously a drug, but it's a powerful medicine. Yeah,
it is. I mean, you're absolutely right. I mean, there are three ways in which the gut and the brain communicate directly. You've got the vagus nerve, which goes from the medulla oblongata down to the gut. And there's a two-way street. There's in fact more signals from the gut to the brain than the other way around. So you can see that the gut does have a big influence on the brain in terms of that gut brain axis. You've got the immune system and how that interacts with the gut and the brain. So the bowel lining is only about one cell thick, and you've got therefore 80% of your immune cells residing right there down in that area, because you have to protect the body from all of these foreign bodies essentially coming inside of the body. You want to make sure that the body's protected. So when you've got 80% of the immune system, the gut associated lymphoid tissue is right there, then that directly communicates with the brain. And you've rightly pointed out the fiber, the short chain fatty acids that are then produced by fiber rich foods, which feed our beneficial gut bugs, and they'll go into the bloodstream and let our brain know that everything's okay. You've got acetate, propionate, butyrate. These are important short chain fatty acids that we get from fiber rich foods. These are, in fact, the prebiotics that feed our probiotics. So we need to make sure we're getting plenty of things like fruits and vegetables and whole grains and beans and lentils and chickpeas and oats and all those foods that contain these incredible short chain fatty acids. That's what the fiber breaks down into. And as you've said, the third way that the gut and the brain intimately communicate is through our microbes. The microbes that live inside our gut, there's more of them than there are stars in the galaxy, and or there should be. And that's part of having a healthy gut, is having that huge variety in gut microbes that help boost our mood. Do reduce serotonin, but it doesn't go directly to the brain. It has other physiological functions, but the gut bugs also help to regulate dopamine, which is another neurotransmitter as well. So there are indirect effects from the gut microbes on the brain. And tryptophan is another thing. So tryptophan is an amino acid that is actually contained quite heavily in meat products. So you would assume then that having a high meat diet would potentially boost your mood, because you'd have more tryptophan with which to make serotonin. Tryptophan is one of the amino acid precursors for serotonin, but it doesn't seem to be the case. And one of the theories around that is that when you're having a generally very high protein meal, the other amino acids contained in the meal can crowd out the tryptophan for access to the brain, because it has to cross the blood-brain barrier in order for the brain to be able to essentially manufacture the serotonin that we talked about. So if you have dietary fiber, it can enhance the ability of the brain to take up the tryptophan. So if you have foods like pumpkin seeds, sunflower seeds, butternut squash, these are high tryptophan foods, but they're also high fiber foods, so they can increase the bioavailability of tryptophan. There was one study in the Journal of Clinical Nutrition that showed us that high healthy carbohydrate foods increase bioavailability of tryptophan. So that's one another potential mechanism. So we've talked about the short chain fatty acids, we've talked about the role of tryptophan and high healthy carb meals allowing that to be more bioavailable. Other vitamins and how they can affect mood, that's another thing. So folate, for example, there's studies to show that having high folate foods can boost the mood, whereas the same doesn't apply for folic acid supplementation, by the way. Having these sort of sources of phytonutrients in their most natural form is supposed to be very good for our mood. What else can I think of? Omega-3s. Mm. So, for example, our Western diet, we need omega-6s and omega-3s. These are essential fatty acids. And we get them from food, and we need omega-6s, and they can come in healthy foods like cashew nuts, for example, but we have them in excess in our modern diets, all the fatty junk sort of foods and the shop-bought biscuits and cakes and things like that. They're very high in omega-6, which again kind of crowds out the omega-3s, which means that we're not going to get the same anti-inflammatory benefits that we would from having foods like flax seeds, chia seeds, hemp seeds, walnuts. And I would also suggest potentially directly taking algae oil supplementation for your long chain omega-3s, EPA, DHA. Homocysteine, that's another potential factor as to nutrition and mood. So homocysteine is another amino acid, and it's heavily associated with increased oxidative stress and inflammation and reduced mood in the body. So what do we do about that? We need to break it down. How do we break down homocysteine? Well, there are three vitamins that we need in order to break it down. We need vitamin B12, B6, and folate vitamin. So fortunately, a healthy plant-based diet will be rich in folate and will be rich in vitamin B6. But unless you're taking a B12 supplement, you may struggle with that. And that's why some vegans have a high homocysteine, is because they may not be mm-hmm. getting enough of the B12. So it's important to get that triad of vitamins dialed in nicely so that you can break down the homocysteine and you can have a nice anti-inflammatory effect on the body.
You are really wonderful at rattling off some nitty-gritty science. I appreciate it.
Oh, good. I'm glad you liked it.
Yeah, it satisfies my intellect. And, you know, it just reminds me that things are super complex in the world of biochemistry and neurobiology and physiology in general. And two, like, you know, we can understand the nitty-gritty kind of reductionistic pathways of how things work. But you pointed out a few times as you're rattling off all that stuff that the isolation of things isn't really the way to go. But just knowing that all of these things are inherently happening when we're covering the bases with a whole food plant-based diet. It's not like we need to go out of our way to get this, this, and this to push that pathway and that pathway. But these are things that are happening when we're eating healthfully, because I think a lot of people listen to this kind of stuff and they pause and they write down B6 and folate, and then they go to the vitamin shop and get the B6 and the folate, and they think, okay, I'm gonna decrease my homocysteine, and you know, it's like, this science is great, but it's just kind of happening.
Yeah, don't worry too much, guys. Just get your whole foods plant-based diet and your B12 supplement and you'll be all right, mostly, for most of us, let's just say. But I mean, also thinking about the microbiome again, you know, you asked me to talk about that. We do need to protect our gut bugs, and that is the most vulnerable aspect of that gut-brain link. You know, the vagus nerve's not going to change. It's not going anywhere. The immune system clearly modulates itself in a variety of ways and is very receptive to diet change. But the most immediate and vulnerable aspect of that link is the microbiome. So that's something that we really need to think about more than anything else, more than taking a supplement. So how can we protect our gut bugs? So,
yeah, totally. And then once again, people jump to, more probiotics, right? Just put more bugs in my mouth. And it's like, no. Well, we have to remember that we're intimately connected with this greater ecosystem. And it's not about just more of this inside here, and like, but it's about the relationship and the
Exactly. And that brings me Yeah. Totally. And that brings me back round nicely to the whole seed and soil analogy. You know, we need to nurture our environment. And how do we do that? Well, we eat mindfully. We think about buying locally, seasonally, organic. We support no-till regenerative agricultural farming. If we can, you know, these are the things, if we have the mental space for that. And clearly, if you're in a severe mental health space, you're not going to be thinking about all of this stuff. But as we're talking about all the ways in which we can generally support connection, body, mind, spirit, and planet, then that's something to consider, is limiting our antibiotic exposure. I don't just mean not taking antibiotics from the doctor unless you absolutely need it. I mean, through factory-farmed meats, for example, they will bioaccumulate antibiotics. That's probably the number one dietary source of antibiotics that we eat every day, three times a day. And we can stop doing that if we don't buy factory-farmed meats, which is pretty much all meat, unless you go out of your way to find some grass-fed beef or organic chicken from somewhere that would be more expensive, which would reflect the true cost of actually raising an animal. Eating plant-based certainly helps with that, because you're going to be eliminating that bioaccumulation of antibiotic. Same with, you know, with the fish and these poor fish in the oceans, you know, they're bioaccumulating PCBs, toxins, heavy metals, which can affect our gut bugs as well as the rest of our body. If we don't eat those, we're not bioaccumulating those things and causing issues with our mental health as well. Other things like, I guess I'm going to scare people now, but... Why not limit your mouthwash, for example? Because that's just killing off the bugs in your mouth. And there's a couple
that's
of studies.
That's not too scary.
No, not too scary. There's a couple of studies to show that you're at increased risk of diabetes if you use mouthwash. Why is that? Because you're killing off the bugs in the mouth that help you produce nitric oxide, which open up your blood vessels. And you can see that, you know, that's a good reason not to use mouthwash. Hand sanitizers, do we really need them unless you're in a sort of acute hospital setting? Probably not. Things like having a pet is a really nice idea for companionship, but also for getting you exposed to a variety of microbes that you may not have had, you know, contact with otherwise. Getting a good night's sleep, again, crucial for mental health, but also helps your gut bugs to survive. Even things like over-exercising can be bad for our gut bugs. Having a great circadian rhythm is really good for our gut bugs because they've got their own circadian rhythm. So, I mean, that's a whole podcast in itself, so I won't go into too much more detail there, but basically just self-love, love through food, and love for your gut bugs.
Yeah. Well, we covered a lot. And, you know, one kind of lingering question that's bubbling up, especially as we're getting into the darker winter months, is like the seasonal affective thing. And I know that's, you know, certain people are more prone to it. But do you have any, you know, for me, I think about vitamin D, of course, and another kind of therapy that I really practice, especially in the wintertime, is hot cold exposure. I was introduced to that and as a way to kind of combat a seasonal affective tendency. I'm wondering if you have any other insights around the colder, darker winter months that tend to maybe aggravate certain people's mental health conditions and maybe push people into darker thoughts and experiences.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think the hot and cold exposure is a great idea. Vitamin D is a really good idea. So it's also probably worth getting a blood test to check your levels.
Yeah.
I think you can get these lamps that will help people who have seasonal affective disorder to sort of increase the amount of, it's not real sunshine, but it's kind of like a sunshine replacement for some people. Just getting outside, to be honest with you, as soon as you wake up, aim to go out into the natural light. It's probably still going to be dark when you wake up, but as soon as it's light, go outside and look up into the sky, whatever the weather. It doesn't have to be a sunny, crisp, cold day. It can be the most foulest of weather. You'll still get loads of photons of light getting into the back of your retina. And that will help sort of start off really kicking in your circadian rhythm. And the melatonin levels, you know, that can then make serotonin, which is the feel-good, as you know, feel-good neurotransmitter. So getting that natural daylight early as you can, will be really helpful. And, you know, I'm wearing these little beauties here. These are blue light blocking glasses. That's something to consider so that your brain can get used to lower light levels when it's closer to the time at which you would normally sleep, which is important. I mean, we don't really know the long-term effects of blue light exposure on the back of the retina. There are some studies to show that it's harmful. And I worry that in the future, we'll be looking at an epidemic of eyesight issues because of our constant blue light exposure. It's good for us in the morning, but not for the whole day. So yeah. I think that blue light blocking glasses, and certainly perhaps limiting your computer time, TV time, tablet time in the evenings, and low light in the evenings, red light. Here's me, you know, with my computer on and all these lights around the house. It's late. This is an exception, but as a rule, that would probably be helpful.
It's because you're in the UK and I'm not.
At least I'm wearing these.
Yeah, that's right. Well, thanks for bringing up the obvious fact that somehow we've skipped over in this conversation of getting outside.
Yeah, and that helps.
I mean, that does help everything, right? And, you know, it just reminds me that even the gloomiest day, like you said, you know, a lot of people have this kind of seasonal thing, but even the gloomiest day, if we can connect with like a sunrise, like that's a really special moment.
Yeah.
And not only is it a special moment, as you pointed out, those photons are hitting the retina and, you know, activating our circadian rhythm and getting things in check on that level as well.
Exactly. And while you're outside, why not take off your socks and just walk around barefoot for a while? That's even better.
Totally. Well, geez, we really did cover a lot in this hour, and I'm so grateful for your time and willingness to open up and share on all these deep topics in the world of nutrition and mental health. And just curious if there's any kind of last lingering things to tie it all together for, to maybe send off to, for people who might be struggling with feelings of anxiety or depression, and to kind of nudge them along in their healing journey.
Last thoughts. I think love is the desire for everything on this planet to thrive and be its full expression. And we have to have love for ourselves, because we are all connected and we are all part of that great all. And if we don't have self-love as the very beginning of all the things we're trying to do, it can be quite difficult to move forward. So look at yourself as though you are your five-year-old you, and talk to yourself in that kind way, because you are deserving of love as much as every other person is deserving of love on this planet. And that will be a fantastic way to start your journey, because the source of all healing is the self.
Love it. Can't say anything more than that. And I love how you reminded us that that's the starting place, because I think a lot of people say, oh, I'll love myself when I feel better or something like that. But it's the place where everything starts. So Dr. Yeah. Gemma Newman, thank you so much for sharing your time and your knowledge and wisdom and experience with us. And peace and love.
Peace and love to you too. Time. It's an absolute pleasure.
Right. Take care.